morning to all those assembled here, and Happy New Year to all of you. We are very pleased at IIT Madras to be able to kick off the new year with this second workshop, annual workshop on computational brain research. Also, doubly pleased that the moving force behind this whole effort at IIT Madras, as well as at the Institute of Science, our distinguished alumnus, board member, and friend, philosopher, and guide, Mr. Chris Gopalakrishnan, is here with us today for this workshop, and very happy with the, as with all the other things that he does with the Institute, he's taking so much personal interest in this, and part of the reason, I think, or probably the, one of the main reasons why this has taken on off with such momentum is because of his commitment and involvement. So thank you very much, Chris. At the outset, I want to mention this. In fact, I also want to thank the and acknowledge the efforts of our three distinguished chairs in computational brain research. The Mahabala chair, the Narayan Murthy chair, and the Muthukrishnan chair. They're all here today, and of course, they've driven this work with intensity. Professors Partha Mitra, Mrigank Sur, and Anand Raghunathan. We are also doubly pleased that Anand Raghunathan has just been nominated for the award 2017 Distinguished Alumnus Awards of this institute. When this was conceived, about little more than 2 years ago, these three chairs were conceived. This whole program was conceived. We had probably 1.5 or 2 faculty, I would say, who had some overlap with this area in some broad sense. We didn't have the kernel of any such program here. And so, but for the fact that Chris had conceived it and had a fairly clear vision, I don't think we would have plunged into it the way we did. It's his commitment and his vision that gave us the confidence, and we said, okay, maybe this will take shape. But we just did not anticipate that it will take shape and form, and you know, with such tangible outcomes in just a short period of 2+ years. We just didn't anticipate this. So it's been a fantastic experience for us as it's evolving to see so many of you here from all over the world, and so many students involved from multiple departments: our computer science department, electrical department, biosciences department. Faculty from so many departments are now involved, students from so many disciplines are involved. Naturally, this is a very interdisciplinary subject. And if you look at the annual report, if you see the kind of directions in which work has taken off, it's really amazing. And it's now becoming clear to us that this is basically becoming a movement of its own. And on behalf of the Institute, I want to assure everybody here, and in particular, I want to assure our distinguished chairs, and I want to assure Chris, that we will do everything we can to make this program not only a great success, but also a benchmark for similar programs across India and in the world. I went through, to the extent I could understand, the brief summary of the results that were obtained by the efforts of our chairs and faculty and students last year. Early results, of course, and very, very intriguing, very exciting. I hope that I'm sure we will pursue all those paths, and I hope that some of them really turn out to be paths in which we find significant and important results and breakthroughs. This is an area which has tremendous potential, both from an applied sense, in the sense that you can improve computing, improve the way we do computing, improve the efficiency with which you do run our algorithms, and reduce the energy with which we solve the problems that we solve today. The second and probably more fundamental aspect is really trying to understand probably for the first time, how our minds, brains really work, and then hopefully from there move on to how our minds might work. So this is a huge, huge untouched area, a mystery, if one wants to call it that, and I hope we can make some beginnings in unraveling some of that. So I'm very pleased on behalf of the Institute and on behalf of myself to be part of this. I wish I could sit here the entire 2 days, but I don't think I can. I will sample this, hopefully with sufficient sampling density that I'll get the correct picture. And I invite everybody who's here today to continue to collaborate with us, especially those who have come from elsewhere. Our international collaborations are very strong. We pay a lot of attention to them. We have a number of very fruitful and growing links with the universities across the world, ranging from just plain and simple collaborations all the way to joint PhD programs. So don't limit what the scope of what you think you might be able to do in collaboration with us. We will make every effort to intensify and intensify the collaborations and make all of them force multipliers for both sides. So I hope that out of this will emerge a number of very interesting and collaborations that also take us in various other new directions, and that this effort will become a huge effort whose size and scope we truly would not have been able to conceive 2.5 years ago or so when it all started. Wish you all a very good workshop, and hope to, of course, keep bumping into you again over the next 2 or 3 days. Thank you very much.
Let me add my welcome to all of you to this workshop. When I looked at the registration, there are about 50 plus faculty and researchers who have registered, and about 100 plus students who registered. So that shows that the interest this is generating, it's growing, and I'm very pleased with the response we're getting. I want to especially welcome the international participants, because they're making an extra effort to be here. I know that it's quite a challenge to travel long distances, plus the jet lag and the new year to be away from family is not easy. So thank you very much. Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, forgot to mention, but you would notice if you look around you, there's a Shastra festival, which is Science, Technology and Engineering Festival of IIT Madras going on in parallel. And I think Sarang is also...
Shastra is today, but Sarang is starting day after tomorrow.
Which is the cultural festival at IIT Madras. So a lot of things are happening at IIT Madras this week. And so you can actually take a little bit probably of all these things. This is the period where in Chennai, a lot of classical and a lot of music festivals are going on, and just December, January. And I want to make sure that when people talk about Chennai, and especially IIT Madras, in the future, they will actually talk about this workshop. So in the first week of January, the place to be in if you're working in any of the related areas of neuroscience, computational brain research, or cognitive sciences, the place to be is IIT Madras. I hope that we can make that indeed happen. We are getting there, but long way to go. I want to thank Partha, Mriganka, Anand, later on Shibab Sharma will also join us. He's the chair at IIS, Indian Institute of Science. The fifth chair is Dr. Vasant Honawar from UPenn. He will be there in Bangalore. I don't know whether he's participating here. And there's one more chair to be filled at Indian Institute of Science. This is the second workshop. And Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy already talked about the results in the last 1 year. I think there's a report that's going to be placed in front of you later this week. And you will see that a lot has been accomplished in the short period of time, especially in terms of the number of papers, joint research work, etc. So I want to thank Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, Professor Nagarajan, and the program committee and the organizers from IIT Madras who have made this happen. Without their complete support, this would not have been possible. I want to wish you all the very best for 2017, the first week. So, and I thought I'll briefly, select some things I want to talk about as major breakthroughs I see, and of course you will have your own list actually. I'll tell you why I chose these. Of course, discovery of gravitational waves, science, engineering coming together in unprecedented ways actually, and probably one of the greatest discoveries in the recent times actually. More importantly, several scientists from India were involved in this. At ICTS, International Center for Theoretical Sciences at Bangalore, at ICER Trivandrum, people from Pune, so in large, and probably, people from IIT Madras, I don't know. So there are large participation from scientists from India in some of the work behind this, especially on the computational side and the theoretical side. The second one I chose were the trials, genetic engineering trials to treat cancer. Again, the reason why I chose was, of course, if we are able to cure cancer, find treatment for cancer, it will be a significant contribution to society. And this is happening because of the marriage of computer science, of course, theoretical science, as well as biology and medicine and things like that. So trials are happening, field trials are happening in places like China. I would like to see field trials happen in India, and probably there's some things we can think about here. The third one is one of the work they've done is at University of Pittsburgh, where they fitted a robotic arm to a patient who is paralyzed, and more importantly, he can of course control this from the brain, the robotic arm, and he has the ability to actually sense touch. And again, it's a marvel of science and engineering, and it shows how we are progressing. And the connection to the brain, to me, was fascinating. That means we're starting to better and better understand how the brain works with the rest of the body, how we are able to connect electrical signals to the brain, and how we can also, get feedback and control signals back to these robotic or these artificial limbs and things like that. The fourth one I chose was, the artificial intelligence progress that we are making. Especially this year, Google's DeepMind was able to beat the human being in the game of Go. It's supposed to be one of the most complex games, and using large amount of computing, and of course the algorithms going behind it, especially machine learning, deep machine learning, they were able to write programs to beat human in the game of Go, which is supposed to be one of the most complex games. Again, I chose because of the intersection of science and engineering, theory, practice and things like that, and of course artificial intelligence. And the last is the field trials of autonomous vehicles, which again is a symbol of what is going to happen in the future. All these show that the world around us is changing. I would like to see, you know, of course there will be progress, but I would like to see global collaboration around these things, especially IIT Madras, Indian Institute of Science, etc., be part of such breakthroughs. And that's what is possible. Now, what is driving this? You know, human performance linearly increases in the sense that, yes, through knowledge, through learning, our own capabilities are increasing. But computer performance, I believe, is exponentially increasing. In the sense that, you know, by using parallel computing, infinite amount of storage, infinite amount of processing capabilities, we are able to far exceed human capabilities. And if you believe in this, then in AI also, at some point, I believe that AI will exceed human intelligence. So when we want to create a machine to go from place A to place B, right? And of course, it has taken a long time. Today, you can go to different planets. You can go to the moon. We have far exceeded human capability. In numerical computing, you know, we can't do billions of calculations per second. Computers can do billions of calculations per second. You know, even if you look at, you know, the ability to destroy things using, let's say, nuclear weapons and things like that, again, far exceeded human capability. So everything that we undertake, over time, we are able to far exceed human capabilities or nature. We're able to far exceed nature. But then, why do we have to go back to nature to learn? Nature has figured out a way to create a sustainable model for development. In billions of years, we have survived. Now, when we far exceed human capabilities and far exceed capabilities nature has created, sometimes we don't anticipate the ill effects or the downside of far exceeding, and that's the reason why we are seeing pollution and things like that. And again, if you look around the campus, nature has its own way of, I would say, responding, because lots of trees are uprooted all around the campuses. Now, we don't know why, what will happen, but it's a way for nature to actually renew itself. Now, I strongly feel that we need to understand this when we far exceed capability. Now, AI, I strongly believe, is going to far exceed human intelligence at some point in the future. What does that mean? So there is a philosophical side to this also. This is a cartoon I found very interesting. Whatever we said the computers can't do, all of them, I think today we will say, you know, computers can do. When we say Go, chess, Jeopardy, these are all, of course, games, but, you know, can we have cars? Only humans can drive cars, right? It's there up in the world, but I think it probably should fall down on the floor. Computers can actually drive cars and things like that. Only human worker can clean a house. We have robots now do that. Humans can translate speech. Google Translate now using AI, machine learning, etc. is actually embarking on that. I won't suggest it. But, you know, parallel computing, big data, deeper algorithms, and of course, the different sciences coming together is making these things happen. Now, from the progress side, now World Economic Forum has said that, you know, this year, last year, 2015, or, well, 2 years back now, 2015 is the beginning of the fourth industrial revolution. And they said this because in the third industrial revolution, we had computers, symbol digitization. In the fourth industrial revolution, we are going to combine physical, digital, and biological systems and combination of technology and artificial intelligence together, creating a new world. When they talk about digital, of course, it's computing. When they talk about physical, it's about intelligence everywhere through Internet of Things. So we'll have intelligence everywhere, which is interconnected. And biological systems, I talked about how we are able to now connect to the brain, how we are able to even, you know, connect to bacteria, cells, living organisms, etc. And more and more we will be able to communicate with them, control them, and that's the, you know, that's the combination which is going to drive the future in the past. Now, let me now briefly touch upon the philosophy behind the Center for Computational Brain Research, and the way this whole initiative is set up is with a premise that global collaboration in research is beneficial to everybody. More people working on the problem from different parts of the world is beneficial to everybody because you get different perspectives. Yesterday, myself and Professor Bhaskaramurthy and Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala were talking about ancient Indian mathematics, where you can actually start computing from the left to the right. You know, we had algorithms to do that actually. You know, normally we do right to left actually, if you think about addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, you know, we do left to right, but in India we had the algorithm to do right to left, sorry, left to right. So, you know, different cultures, different, you know, communities coming together brings different perspective to the research work and maybe new thinking to that. I think it's an opportunity. We want to leverage, of course, the talent that's available in India, again, because of the different background and the ethnicity and the diversity that it brings. Even when it comes to brain research, for example, multilingual capabilities, different food habits, you know, people who are vegetarians, rich and poor, you know, you find extreme poverty and extreme wealth in India. Food habits widely varying within the same country. So a lot of diversity is there, and you know, we can leverage that diversity for doing this research, especially on the medical and healthcare side. And with India involved, I also believe that you can get, of course, faster because more people are involved, cheaper because the cost of doing something in India is different, much lower. If you spend $5, and if you take US for example, and maybe $2 in India, you can actually double the research output. So that is again a opportunity for us, and that's kind of the philosophy behind the Center for Computational Brain Research. Now, coming to why the brain, it's the last unknown, especially when it comes to human or biology. After gene sequencing, DNA sequencing, and things like that, it's something that is fascinating all of us. And with DNA sequencing, you are starting to unravel the code of life. You know how nature passes its information from one generation to another generation. But at some point in evolution, the brain was created, and you created something that can learn. So the question is, why evolution created the brain? Why did learning come about? Why did nature believe that learning is necessary for survival? And then how brain has evolved over time? And understanding the brain allows us to understand, again, nature, and I say this with the belief that we need to understand computer science better. I believe that computer science is at a crossroad at this point. The way computer science has evolved, because of historical reasons, you know, we started with very simple machines, which were primarily finite state automata machines, so which had one model of computing, the procedural model of computing. And it started evolving based on that, and all of some computer science in some senses is based on those set of principles actually. And the model is, you understand a problem, you create an algorithm to solve the problem, you program that, and you let the machine run. And that's been our model of computing till now. And it has, and I last year also talked about it, it has created a world of software. We are drowning in software today. We have huge challenges of the amount of software that exists in the world, and trying to maintain that and things like that. And imagine the world full of computing devices, everything that you can think of, having programs running them, and the complexity that will create. So is there a better model of computing? And we are moving towards infinite computing and infinite storage, available to everybody who can access it using a mobile phone. And then the intelligent devices that we will percolate the world with, all of them are interconnected now in that world. And that's why I said computing capability is going to exceed human capability at some point. But then what is the model that we would use to use this capability that we are creating? Is there a better model? Can we learn from the brain what that model is? Today, for example, machine learning requires large amounts of data. Now, with brain, even with one instance of the data, single data point, we start actually coming out with some solutions, approximate solution and things like that. And that's the, those are some of the reasons. Of course, understanding the brain allows us to also look at aging related diseases, mental disorders, things like that. We will also be able to come up with, let's say, low power computing, because, a world full of computers will require power to be driving all that. That's huge amount of power that we will require. So there are lots and lots of things that we can come up with. This is at the highest level. I think several questions actually. At least to me, several questions actually. When we look at the brain, and that's why I believe this is an interesting field. And of course. We need to pick one field, and I suggested this, IIT Madras accepted that, and so we are here today. So the future is about augmenting human and machine capabilities. It's not or, we are going to increase machine capabilities, and with that we will also augment human capabilities, and both will have to coexist and work together. In the future, and we need to prepare ourselves to a world where we, we look at ourselves as coexisting with machines together, and augmenting our capabilities with machines. But machines' capabilities are also increasing immensely. There is a center here at IIT Madras, so this conference is. By the center. There's a center at Indian Institute of Science also. I talked about two of the chairs there. The third chair is empty at this point. And in fact, the report will be given to you during the workshop. You will see that significant progress has been made. Of course, a lot more we should be aiming to achieve. So both these centers are actually working together in putting these things together. So this workshop is actually followed by a workshop at Indian Institute of Science between 9th and 13th. Some of you are participating in that workshop also. So this is a way to leverage two of the best research facilities in India with all the capabilities that exist around the world. So with that, I'm wishing you a great week here at IIT Madras, and for those people who are coming to ISC, another week of excitement. and ISE. Thank you all very much.